a lot about that report, and would be good to dig in with questions on that if you have them. Then we have Dan Caprio, who's the executive chairman of the Providence Group. Dan has an extensive background in government service here in the U.S. and working with foreign governments. He's been on staff at the Commerce Department, the FTC, and the Department of Homeland Security, and now runs his own firm. And then our final panelist is Steve Oshansky, who is the Trust and Identity Program Lead at the Internet Society, and he's an expert in trust and security. So obviously lots of different perspectives on this topic represented on the panel. So Dan, maybe I'll just start with you, if I may, just to ask you to frame a little bit for us the discussion. I think IoT is a term that a lot of people associate with smart thermometers in their home, or thermostats rather, in their home, or that type of device. But there's really a broadening group of devices that may come under this category. I think earlier today someone was talking about self-driving cars as one. So what, just very basically, what should we be thinking about today as the definition of the Internet of Things? Well, start with that.
Thanks, Nanette, and thanks to State of the Net for hosting this panel, and thanks for, it's good to see so many people, you know, in this room. Having worked on this for a dozen years or so, I think what we're talking about is, you know, the connection of everyday devices to the Internet, and then the systems that support it, kind of its most basic level. And so especially when the topic of today's panel, when we're talking about cybersecurity, we have to kind of keep in mind that there's an entire ecosystem related to cybersecurity. We can delve into all that. But the Internet of Things is really kind of an evolution and not a revolution. So, I mean, we heard Commissioner Olhausen this morning talking about autonomous vehicles. And so the things that have really captured people's imaginations, you know, the notion of smart cities, of wearable technology, of smart cars. We're going to talk a little bit more, I think, about, you know, some technical solutions and the engineering and the network itself. But I think one thing that we ought to consider, and then the Dyn attack certainly brought this into sharp focus, you know, last November when it hit the DNS. But the Internet of Things, it raises the stakes significantly when events begin to, you know, now that events can affect medical devices, supply chains, mentioned smart cars, but the possibility of real or physical harm. So I think that this reality, which is now upon us, represents a shift in the potential physical effects of incidents. And in the past, that were generally just isolated to industrial control system environments or the network itself. So, it's a big topic for the first day of a new administration, and I'm sure we'll get into all that as well. But it's kind of the future of the Internet itself, and we need to guard it and protect it very carefully.
Right, and maybe we should give a little bit of an explanation of what the Dyn attack was so that people in the room understand. I mean, maybe you're all very familiar with it, but I know, Jason, do you want to take that just to explain a little bit about what happened and what we might be learning from it?
Sure, so that attack was actually pretty interesting, and if you haven't seen it, if you follow the reporter Brian Krebs, he did a great article, I think it was on Friday or over the weekend, really trying to trace back potentially one of the people or sort of the networks behind it and the causes for it, which are really interesting. But in essence, and this is something that the BTAG report touches on, it really leverages a lot of insecure devices. What does that mean? Devices that are running open ports that aren't used, so it's not secured and it's listening on these ports for really no functional purpose. And the devices use default usernames and passwords, so think admin and password. It's very easy to script that kind of attack to go out and scan these ports and then try to log in with that. And then once someone was able to log in with that default username and password, they were able to cause that device to download and update from an unsecured or untrusted location. So it really failed on a lot of fronts. And then, you know, these, just like any other form of malware that might attack a Windows machine or whatever else, you form them into big bot armies. And from a network operator perspective, it really just looks like normal traffic because it's distributed across such a wide number of devices. But that was really the few key things that went wrong. And unfortunately, you know, there were a lot of things I think we can learn from that. We'll talk about that maybe later. But the one device that was one of the big participants was a security camera from Dahua Security, kind of ironically named, I think. And, you know, they had no way to even get in touch with their users to tell them to update the software and so on. So maybe we can talk about that later on. But really the combination was, you know, open ports that weren't needed and weren't secured, default usernames, passwords, and then allowing software to be applied from an untrusted location.
Absolutely. Nick, I don't know if you want to add something to that. You've done a lot of research in your own lab looking at devices and, you know, what vulnerabilities might be. I'm sure you would have some interesting insights into those connections.
Yes, thanks, Nanette. I think I'll take this opportunity to talk a little bit about what motivated the BTAG report, as well as some of our observations that we made in the lab at Princeton. So we built, over the past 2 years, a smart home lab, and the goal of that is really sort of twofold. One is to examine the status quo, both respect to security and privacy, and the other is to look at sort of design both the ideal and evaluate what an ideal design technically might look like for the future. In the lab, we saw a bunch of things that are actually highlighted in the BTAG report observations, including the lack of encrypted communication, the lack of authenticated communication. So those two things are different, right? The first one is really communication in the clear. There's a lot of traffic information about you, your activities, et cetera, that these devices were transmitting just for any eavesdropper to see. The second one, I mentioned lack of authentication there. There are a lot of devices, actually, that we found that would basically accept software updates from anybody, anywhere. And those two things, actually, we found sort of would, quote-unquote, fail independently. There were some devices that did have encrypted communication but would accept updates from unauthenticated sources. And the reason behind that appears to be sort of relating to another observation that and set of recommendations that the BTAG report makes, which is this dependence on the software supply chain, right? So often these device manufacturers do not have software engineering or testing capabilities, so they'll pull basically the lowest barrier to entry as far as, you know, this library supports encrypted communication, this one supports software updates, it happens not to use authentication, so we'll just sort of pull things off the shelf and turn the key. So those are some of the observations that we've been making in the lab, and I'd be happy to sort of talk further about that as the panel continues.
Sure. Ron, maybe you can add a little bit from your perspective as to how this fits into the broader systems that you've been studying, the broader issues of privacy and cybersecurity.
Sure. Thank you. You know, this is a really interesting time because what we're witnessing, all of us, is this massive convergence of cyber and physical systems. The technology is getting so powerful and so compelling, and we pretty much love everything that our great IT industry can give to us. But at the same time, all of that great new capability is building out an infrastructure, an IT infrastructure that is incredibly complex. And we've actually outstripped our ability at this point with the complexity, which translates in the security world to increased attack surface. The more things you put on the network, the Internet of Things, the billions of devices, you basically give the adversaries more opportunity to do mischief. And if you combine that with an almost total lack of caring about the trustworthiness of those devices, in other words, we're focused on the capability. I want a good baby monitor. I want a good DVR. I want a car that can drive itself to the dealer and fix itself and bring itself home. And those things are all possible because we have great IT innovation in this country. But at some point, this is going to become more of a societal discussion. At NIST, we've been focusing on this. The recent publication that we put out in November, it's a System Security Engineering Guidance Document. It represents 4 years worth of effort, bringing forward 40 years worth of best practices in how to build more trustworthy products and systems. We know how to solve this problem, actually. The question is, do we have the political will, the societal will, to actually solve the problem? And it's going to be one of those really important decision points, inflection points, where we're going to have to decide. It's like on your smartphone. You can download hundreds, maybe thousands of applications on your smartphone. But that's all you see at the top layer. We describe cybersecurity as being above the waterline things which users and all of us can see at the top level. And then there's everything below the waterline. Just like sharks and glaciers, everything bad with sharks and glaciers happens below the waterline. That's where the hardware, the software, and the firmware is resident. An operating system today alone has maybe over 60 million lines of code. And on top of that are hundreds and thousands and millions of applications. Who knows where they're built, how they're built? You've heard a couple of just comments this morning about the total lack of system security engineering best practices putting into these components. So when you couple this massive innovation, massive complexity, and a total lack of integrating the best practices that we know how to do, it's no surprise that you're seeing cyber attack after cyber attack. And the long term, you know, the real insidious part of this is when you attack a system, you mentioned the DDoS attack, that's an attack you can observe. You see the internet go down. Or Mr. Krebs notices he can't use his website anymore. But that's only half the problem. The bigger problem is what we call the exfiltration attack. That's what happened at OPM when they were in the system for 7 months and they emptied out every bit of important information that we kept on all of our background check information for all the security clearances. Or they go in and they steal the F-35 design documentation. Or they go into Silicon Valley, a company, and steal intellectual property. See, those kind of attacks largely go undetected, and the adversaries, it's not that hard. They can be everywhere in your network, and you may never know they're there. So it's kind of like, I use the term kinetic space versus cyberspace. We have a tendency to think in terms of kinetic space. You see the airplanes flying to the World Trade Center, hit the Pentagon. You can see it, you internalize it. Those cyber attacks are below the radar. It's like having cancer in the early stages. You know, you're feeling fine walking around, the cancer cells are doubling, and then they attack your organs and you die. This is why this problem is the greatest national security problem that we face going forward, because we are pushing computers to the edge, and that means in everything, from your toaster to your refrigerator to power plants to medical devices, and it's all powered, fueled by software and firmware, and most of it is not trustworthy. So if you want to roll the dice, like Clint Eastwood said, are you feeling lucky today? That's the situation we're in. So the real question is, and all of us have to answer, and it's going to be your generation, I'm going to be off the stage pretty soon, but it's the millennials and all the young people today are going to have to figure out, you know, where's that balance point? Do I want that device that can do everything but has no protection? Or do I want a device that can do most things but it's more protected? It has more trustworthiness. That's the big question I think we have to look at.
Steve, let me bring you in. Can you talk a little bit about the economics of this, right? As a business editor, I think it's really important to fill in that understanding. What is the incentive for companies that are building IoT devices to build in proper security and privacy protections in there? And what are the counter forces that might make that less appealing?
Yeah, I think that's the result or the cause of a lot of. That's the cause of a lot of what we're seeing is that the risks and the costs are diffused and not clear. There's a lot of vendors who are rushing products to market because of market forces, competitive nature. And they're not necessarily spending the time and the money it takes to build in security from the beginning, because it's complicated, it costs money, and it slows things down. And there is such a competitive rush to bring your products to market at this point that it's hard to do security as an afterthought, as a bolt-on. And so the economics are kind of turned around in some way. Plus, the fact that once you've sold these products out into the market, there is, in many cases, very little incentive to go back and try to fix them. and try to correct things that you identify later. One thing that I would note is NTIA's software upgrade and patchability multi-stakeholder process. Alan Friedman's in the room here. I think that's a really excellent effort because it's the kind of thing that industry needs to get a hold of on their own instead of waiting for the government to regulate or policymakers, because there's a real opportunity here to get ahead of this and try to ensure that the trustworthiness is there, which has been quite correctly pointed out, is lacking in many cases. The security and privacy impacts as well. It's hard in many cases to put economic value to those. In some cases it's obvious, in many cases it's not. In many cases it's not clear to the impacted user that their privacy or security has been breached. In many cases the harms can flow both way, both internal and external. The user of the device may not even know that their security camera has been compromised and is now part of a botnet. And it's very hard to tell in many cases. So it's a very complex environment. It's not easy. If it was easy, we would have fixed it by now. but I would point out that there are good efforts underway, and I think this NTIA process is one of them.
So we've talked about the problem, I think, a little bit. Let's talk a little bit about what solutions might look like. And I'd like to start, because I think a lot of people here are very interested in policy, with a little bit of an understanding of, up to this point, has the FTC and Commerce Department shown a high level of interest in setting standards on privacy and security in the IoT and enforcing those? And this is something, you know, whoever on the panel wants to answer can, but if you want to start, Dan, that would be great.
Thanks. Yeah, I've been thinking about this a lot over the weekend, the notion of, you know, protecting privacy and security and enabling innovation. And I think, you know, it's, I mean, I think what we're facing in D.C., you know, is change like we haven't seen in our lifetime. And, I mean, that has an effect on technology policy, has an effect on the Internet of Things. And, you know, Senator Schatz, before our panel, mentioned the notion of doing no harm. And he said that the old statutory infrastructure weighs down innovation, and we still need rules of the road. So we do need some rules of the road for privacy and cyber. But I think with the focus of the new Trump administration, there's not going to be anything incremental about what the Trump administration does. They're going to be solely focused on economic growth and, you know, the big agenda for creating jobs. And so I think the argument or the way to think about this is in terms of leadership. And, I mean, privacy and security, I think, have over the years, but the Dyn attack and the possibility of physical harm have come to maturity. And in some ways, it's really on industry and CEOs to kind of step up and lead. But I do see a shift, you know, where this has been pretty well shared, at least initially, by the executive branch and the legislative branch. I think there's going to be more of a shift, more of a focus on this in the legislative branch. And, of course, the FTC is going to continue to be consistent and continue with the excellent work that the FTC has done for years and years and years. I mean, Commissioner Ohlhausen mentioned the FTC IoT report from 2 years ago. I mean, and that's still applicable today, but I think we're, you know, we're going to see some big changes in the focus, and we need to tie privacy and security into, you know, how does it really roll up to innovation and economic growth?
Please go ahead.
Yeah, so, you know, just to add to that, I mean, I think we're in a phase of the development of the market that it seems most appropriate for the industry to try to take some action and to organize itself. It's a very dynamic marketplace. The even the roles that people are playing or organizations are playing are unclear. You know, I think one of the challenges has been that many of the companies making some of the less secure devices are really at root hardware, you know, companies. They think probably first and foremost about the industrial design and what chips go in. The very last thing they think about is the software and the security, when in fact that's sort of the cornerstone of the device in a way. And so I think that there's an opportunity. This was one of the recommendations of the BTAG for industry groups to, you know, focus on sort of logo programs of some sort, certification programs. This might be something like the OCF, which is the Open Connectivity Foundation, or the CTA. There's a whole range that are sort of starting to work on this, but I think they'll have to start to focus a little bit more intently on it this year. Certainly, if attacks continue to happen, I think you'll see a lot more pressure in D.C. for industry to take action here. And just to think about it or contextualize this, the Dyn attack, while that was very large, 1.5 or 6 terabits per second, that was in the order of 100,000 or so devices. Now play that forward a few years. You have billions of new devices on the network, at some point 20 billion devices in the next few years. Many of these connected to gigabit per second connections at home. The amount of firepower that you can unleash is tremendous. So, you know, I think those organizations have to get together, and I think, you know, they're starting to. There's activity, so I'm optimistic, but, you know, we'll really see. They'll have to get things done this year, I think.
I think the comments from the commissioner this morning about the role of the FTC in solving some of these problems were quite encouraging. She observed, you know, and I've heard this before as well, the commission's role as a convener in through workshops, competitions, et cetera. And I think we've seen some really encouraging developments there. PrivacyCon, for example, the last several years, and we had a session on IoT security and privacy at PrivacyCon this year with some very interesting work. I think the other thing that, that the commissioner actually mentioned in her comments this morning was the Home Inspector Challenge. That one kind of warms the cockles of my heart, actually. As a network security researcher, you know, dating back to spam and phishing and antivirus and denial of service, we gave up on securing the host software a long time ago and have been looking at network-level solutions to these problems for, you know, 10 or 15 years now. And I think the Home Inspector Challenge is interesting because it does propose that kind of bump in the wire, assuming that they're going to be, you know, that we're not going to secure all these IoT devices. They're not going to be completely well-behaved. And the BTAG report also makes some observations about that, as well as sort of the potential role of having some device sitting in the home network, you know, inspecting, just doing things as simple as telling a user, you know, what devices are connected to your home network. Seemingly simple question that's actually pretty darn hard these days. As well as providing users visibility into and control over the traffic that these devices are sending. Is that thermostat just talking to Nest or Google, or is it also talking to other strange places? That's something that's just way too hard to answer right now, and I think the FTC, through their home inspector challenge, is definitely getting not just policymakers, but also the technical folks thinking in the right direction, I think.
Is it necessary to have one the commission, like one group that takes the lead on this? It does seem that there are a lot of different strands that come together and potentially affect different parts of the government, and I'm curious about what people think about that.
I'll take that. I think it's an issue of leadership, which I think is going to be consistent, you know, throughout government and the legislative branch. I'm not sure. I mean, from my earlier comment about the, it seems like the new Trump administration is going to focus on big things and not incremental things, and as they focus on economic growth, I'm not sure we're going to see the same focus on the conversation about national strategies. But, you know, we still have a lot of folks that are working to kind of you know, move the Internet of Things ahead. But I think really, and you're drawing this out in this panel, that it's really, and we've talked about this for years and years, but it's really time for industry to step up and you know, get privacy right. I mean, it's easier said than done, but get privacy right, get security right. But focus on this, you know, focus on the Internet of Things is really a strategic risk management issue. I mean, at the CEO level, at the board level, and we've got some tools for that. You know, we've got the NIST cybersecurity framework, which you can, that's voluntary and it's flexible. You can tie to that. There are things that you can do, but like a lot of things in that are related to to privacy and cyber. This is no longer just, I mean, the engineering and the IT, it's real important, and it's never been more important. But, I mean, to really sort of move this ahead in terms of economic growth and innovation, I think companies, CEOs, are really going to have to focus on this across the entire enterprise and make, you know, make security a priority, not just a compliance checklist.
Just to add one quick note, you know, I think we have to be careful when, you know, if you think about it from a regulatory or a government perspective, you know, the internet doesn't respect national borders. And it's a bit like pollution. You know, we might have really great standards here, but other countries can also be the sources of attack. And the internet, by its nature and its power, is in its decentralized nature. And so I think a viable solution here is going to also have to be decentralized. And you can't expect any one country to sort of lead the way. It's going to take a lot of groups working together because that's the way the internet works. And I think it's a bit of an illusion to think that, you know, any one agency or country can sort of solve this. There's not a silver bullet. It's a very complicated, you know, global thing that the world has to face. And it's not also not just about the devices themselves, but the data and where that data goes once it's sort of out of the device. So it's a very complicated decentralized solution, and I think that's sort of the focus here.
So one thing that can kind of clarify the mind on this sort of question is the legal system and the question of liability. Who's liable when these outer edges of the Internet of Things are taken over for illicit purpose? And I'd be happy to have everyone on the, you know, anyone who wishes to comment, but maybe we'll start with you, Steve.
Well, I mean, that's an interesting point because the old adage, follow the money, I think really applies here. I mean, until there starts being real liability issues arising from industry for having, or real impacts and repercussions from selling insecure and devices that do not respect privacy, it's going to be hard. And to Jason's point about this being an international and decentralized issue, I think the multi-stakeholder approach really is at play here, because you can't legislate for the world. You know, jurisdiction and enforcement are hard. You can't just make a law in the U.S. and expect that the whole world is going to snap to attention and abide by it. And it's a very complex environment. The supply chains, as has been pointed out, are becoming extremely complex and hard to track down. You know, a supplier of a security camera in China doesn't know who all has bought and is distributing those products to its customers. And it's very, people need to take into account that this is not an easy issue. It's becoming more complex by the minute, and there are no quick and easy solutions. But to the extent that the public and private sectors can partner in this and really come together, because as has been correctly pointed out, in my opinion, and I think others as well, that, you know, that the industry really needs to step up. And it's the opportunity and the role here for industry to get ahead of this. And there is a real opportunity to partner with governments. But it is an international issue, and you can't just make a law and assume that it's fixed and move on.
Anyone else want to talk about liability or the legal ramifications?
Sure. So I think Jason just reminded me that there have been some high-profile cases as well, such as the D-Link case recently that the FTC brought, that certainly dragging, you know, high-profile cases like that out, you know, dragging the vendors out onto the carpet may have some impact. Another thing I wanted to mention as well is, and I think this came up not explicitly in the BTAG report, but certainly as we presented it on the Hill and elsewhere, was that there are other choke points in industry, such as distribution points, retailers, et cetera. So Jason made the comment earlier about certification and, you know, where might that be implemented? One possibility is through distribution channels and retailers, and I think it remains to be seen whether consumers actually would pay attention to that or care about it and how to raise awareness. So it's probably not as simple as just slapping a label on the box and being done with it, or slapping a label on the Amazon page and being done with it. But I think it behooves us to think about, you know, from manufacturing to market, where are those choke points and where might some of these incentives be, you know, best implemented?
I'm kind of struck by the, it, when you talk about cybersecurity and the desperation of the comments, it's almost we throw our hands up like, this problem is too hard. It's his fault. It's her fault. It's industry. It's government. The reality is, you know, we've solved problems like this before. All of you drive cars. My first car barely had a seatbelt, and it had an 8-track back in those days. Those of you don't remember what that is, but there was an evolution. You know, there's regulation on one hand, and then there's the free market on the other. And we've managed to figure out in that instance. Talk about California. I lived in California, and they set the standard for emission control. And what California did ended up spreading throughout the country. You didn't have to involve the whole world. You can take care of a lot of business right here in this country, and it takes leadership. And the question is, when you have regulation on one hand, or you have free market on the other, where's the balance point in between? We know that regulation can stifle innovation, and we don't want to do that completely because we pride ourselves on innovation, you know, all the great things that are produced by the great companies. On the other hand, the free market sometimes doesn't produce the kind of trustworthy things that we need to protect ourselves, and unless we as consumers actually make the argument why I'm not going to buy that product because it's not trustworthy, unless we start to weigh in on those things, but this is where cyber and kinetic space separate. Because if we were seeing automobiles crash on the beltway, every other car was the brakes were failing, or if every other airplane that took off ended up in the ditch somewhere with people dying, we wouldn't be having that discussion. We wouldn't be throwing our hands up and in this desperation. But when it comes to cyber and the internet, man, we can't seem to get our arms around it. There is a way to solve the problem. NIST is producing a lot of engineering related guidance, great standards, security controls, frameworks. They all work in a complementary fashion, but we are not a regulatory body. You know, all we can do is produce the best vehicles, tools, techniques, and standards that industry and consumers need to implement in order to be effective. And so I think the bigger discussion is going to have to be, where is that balance point? We have a little bit of regulation in the automobile industry. We've gone from seatbelts to airbags to steel-reinforced doors. Some of those were mandatory by regulation. Others, automobile manufacturers, produced in their cars because they wanted to give you a safer product. And I've got some friends of mine that will pay a couple $1,000s more for a car. This was about 10 years ago because one of the manufacturers was putting steel-reinforced doors in the car. They had young kids, and they wanted that protection. They're willing to pay for it. But you have to be able to make this transition from kinetic thinking to cyber and understand that just because you can't see it doesn't mean you're not getting taken to the cleaners below the surface that you can't see. And that's a big issue today. And unless we can get our arms around that problem and say, look, we've sent people to the moon. That was not easy. We certainly can do two-factor authentication, other things that can help make these products more secure. But what's the margin? You know, when you're building a baby monitor and the margin is very thin and you want to make the best baby monitor, is that mother or father going to really care that that baby monitor requires you to change the default password before you can plug it in and use it? That's going to cost. That's going to require some engineer to go in there and design some software and integrate that software into that product, and that's going to increase the cost of that product. Now, if one manufacturer is doing that and the other ones aren't, and your criteria for selecting a good baby monitor is the cost, then that new manufacturer that's bringing that added capability to the table, it's not going to win. So that's why we have, as consumers, we have to speak loudly and make our voices heard. And that's where industry responds. So short of regulation, industry will respond to customers. That's what they do. And so that's where we have to go, I think, in order to make this effort start.
Just to amplify one thing real quickly, I mean, I think you make an excellent point that this is a solvable problem. This is not some mysterious thing that we're not sure how to solve. And a lot of these things are very basic. You know, you're talking about automatic secure software updates and closing unnecessary ports, and a lot of those things are in some of the NIST documents that, you know, somebody can just go and say, oh, I'm going to follow these steps. So I think you're right. It just takes attention. And these are things that can be solved if someone decides to make the investment.
And one other point about the vastness of the Internet of Things. Some people will throw their hands up and say, there's just too many devices out there. There's 8 billion now, and there's going to be 20 billion in 5 years from now, and we just can't do all that. Well, you know, you can build a very trustworthy and safe automobile. And you can drive it on the Beltway. You don't have to be worried about everybody else out there, what they're doing. They may be driving cars that are just not protected as well. You have the airbag, you have the seatbelt, you have the steel reinforced doors, that's all you care about. That we kind of have to do that. It's mutual suspicion. You have to treat everything out there as being untrustworthy and start with protecting yourself first. And then everything you bring into your world, you have to realize there's some level of trustworthiness. When devices communicate, there's going to be some level of trustworthiness in each one of those devices. And we need to have the transparency from the manufacturers to know exactly what that level of trustworthiness is, so we can make decisions on whether I'm going to connect up or not. And I think we can make those reasonable decisions if we get good information.
So I just wanted to make a quick plug, having talked about the role of the executive branch, the role of the legislative branch, the work at the FTC, just to put a plug back in the original question about liability. There's some interesting, I think the judicial branch is probably going to help sort this out. I think within the executive branch and the legislative branch on the Hill, the issue of liability is going to be very difficult to resolve. But, you know, I think the courts, even though they're, you know, I mean, things maybe take longer than we would like or we would hope, but I think some of the liability questions we're going to begin to see cases that will start to resolve some of the liability that's related to substantial and tangible harm.
Just to echo a couple of points, I think, again, I think very astute observation that a lot of the problems are solvable. I won't repeat that again, but I think one thing I think there is the importance of lowering the barriers, right? So this is lowering the barrier for developers, right? Someone basically is building a new product. They basically are going to take the software library that's easiest to obtain, easiest to install, is going to get them up and running quickly. So I think Jason already mentioned OCF, the Open Connectivity Foundation, and I think some of the activities that they are doing, both through standardization and through the IoTivity open source development platform, I think these are going to be very important for lowering the barriers to actually implementing some of these recommendations, because, you know, the BTAG report and others can say all these great things about what should happen, but if they're not easy for people to do or low cost, it's going to be very difficult to make that happen. I think one other point I wanted to sort of come back to, you know, the analogies to transportation and et cetera, I think some of them carry over, but I think there's one sort of point that I think we should be aware of. It comes back to a point Steve made at the beginning, which is that the risks and the harms are actually somewhat diffuse as well in this case, right? So I might buy a security camera with weak authentication or encryption, and if that participates in a denial of service attack, I'm not the victim necessarily. And it's worse than that, right? I may not even notice a degradation to my internet performance. So if you're going to ask the typical consumer, are they going to pay, you know, an extra N cents or N dollars for something that's going to, you know, produce no noticeable improvement in their experience, that may be a trickier sell. On the other hand, privacy is often direct harm to the consumer who's making that choice, right? So now if I talk about, will you pay an extra N cents or N dollars so that I'm protected against data leaks or against attacks against other devices in my own home, which, for example, have happened with light bulbs mounting denial of service attacks against you know, other devices in the home, then the consumer might actually make a different choice. So I think there are things to think about there as we think about sort of technical solutions to some of these problems. There are some that actually solve both, right? Some of the solutions to the privacy problems the consumer cares about with regards to encryption, authentication, network isolation, et cetera, may also solve some of these security problems, which are thornier when it comes to incentives.
I think at the end of the day, a lot of this distills down to both opportunities and obligations. Opportunities in the sense of making it a competitive advantage. My baby monitor protects your privacy, and here's why it's worth $3 more. I think, you know, if enough education and movement behind this starts forming, then I think that can be a real competitive advantage. The obligation part of that equation is that the manufacturers and the vendors of these devices have obligations to be good netizens, to make sure that you're not selling a baby monitor that can be easily compromised and be part of a botnet. because it's just part of being a good corporate citizen, a good internet citizen. This is what you do, and that too is a competitive advantage. You know, we have really instilled, we've taken the 20 extra cents in our product to do this. To the earlier point, a lot of these devices are very constrained. They have very little capability to do a lot of the things that we care about, encryption, authentication, et cetera. And if you're making a $2 light bulb, there's not a lot of margin in there to be able to spend a little bit more and put the security in there. But that's where I think being a competitive advantage really factors in.
I'm going to ask one more question and then see if there are questions in the room. But an attack like the attack against Dyn results in inconvenience. Twitter went down. Netflix went down. Our website went down for a period of time. But it's not the end of the world. There are connected devices in hospitals as we talk about cars becoming more connected. What are the odds that what ends up bringing awareness to this is a true disaster, something that involves somebody dying?
Well, you know, that's the part of the problem that's difficult, because we tend to think of in terms of cyber Pearl Harbors. And when you think about cyber Pearl Harbor, you're thinking about Pearl Harbor, and you're looking at for the equivalent of something disastrous happening. The reality is that the cyber attacks have been going on so long, the adversaries are so sophisticated, and the vast majority are the types of attacks that you may never see that are ongoing with this exfiltration of information. That's kind of the slow bleed. You know, you can take a company, cutting-edge firm in Silicon Valley. We do a lot of research and development in this country, and if that research and development is compromised by the IP being stolen, that's going to have a long-term degradation on the national economy and our ability to compete around the world and have cutting-edge technologies. So there is the fear that, for example, in power plants, how many power plants have been already compromised by pre-positioned malicious code where adversaries can flip the switch whenever they want to and bring down a power plant in Chicago that could take the city offline for 4 months? And all of you know in D.C., when we've been lucky this year, but you know when we have a blizzard or we lose power for a couple of days, we get a little cranky. Hurricane Katrina, power goes out for a month or two, you see the society starts to break down. Even in Hurricane Sandy up in New Jersey, when they lost power after 3 or 4 days, the lines at the gas station start to form. People start to have fist fights at gas stations. You see, we are very fragile in this society. When you build a society that's based on high tech, that's kind of, you live by high tech and you can die by high tech. We're very fragile. And when this technology is not dependable, those kind of things can happen in a nanosecond. And that's why I think we have to be proactive in this whole space and not wait for that power plant to be compromised or that medical device to fail, because they will at some point. Just a question of when. The exfiltration is happening now. And, you know, you'll find out when your competitor launches that new product that you thought you had a market on, and they can bring it to market before you do. You say, how'd that happen? Well, we probably know how that happened.
Next.
So one of the comments you just made relates to the fragility of the underlying infrastructure, and I think that's an important thing to sort of draw out a little bit more in talking about risk and resilience. The original question was about, you know, how long before there's something catastrophic, and I think going back to the Dyn attack, right, something that I think can be easy to forget or overlook is that attack traffic was not directed at Twitter. It wasn't directed at your site, right? It was directed at DNS servers, right? In some sense, critical infrastructure. So you might not have been the direct target, but you were collateral in that case. Well, I don't think it's very hard to imagine a situation where there's some other collateral damage in one of these attacks, because they're not often directed at a particular victim. They're directed at the weakest link. And that weakest link, or that part of the infrastructure that everybody is depending on, may end up taking down more than just the intended target. So I think, to answer your question, we're really not that far away right now.
Yeah, and that's why I mentioned it at the beginning. I think Dyn is just the tip of the iceberg. I think, unfortunately, we're probably a lot closer you know, to an attack on critical infrastructure that begins to, you know, that affects life and property, you know, whether it's in a utility plant or whether it's a smart car or, you know, whether it's a medical system. And so we're really, you know, we're racing against the clock because, you know, we've seen what's happening to our systems and networks. And it's, I think, unfortunately, it's really only a matter of time before we're going to see real harm, I mean, in terms of loss of life. And once that happens, you know, the old saying in Washington, I mean, there are some sayings that are still true. The pendulum never swings halfway. If we get to that point, you know, where you've got life and property and physical harm, the pendulum is going to swing real fast and real quickly toward regulation.
Are there questions in the audience? Let's start back there. Okay. There's a mic.
Yeah, I have one question, and I think one of the panelists mentioned this in terms of bringing devices into your domain, which I think is an overlooked part of this. Is we've got this new, you know, convention now, or whatever you want to call it, of, you know, this matching of physical and digital ownership, and how do we define that? I've got, you know, maybe 50 plus IP devices in my house right now. If I sold my house, a lot of those wouldn't go with me, they would go with the house. And how do I transfer all that with the associated, you know, deletion of privacy and reprovisioning of all the services and everything? How do I do that in any sort of form that's, you know, reasonable? And I think, you know, that is not discussed in this whole thing. And so the life cycle aspect of digital ownership, to me, is not being captured in some of these conversations. It's almost like a snapshot type thing, but not looking at the overall digital ownership life cycle of this stuff.
Yeah, I think that's a great question. The digital privacy, or sort of, you know, ownership of data and so on, is one of the big, I think, unanswered questions, and it's really complicated. You know, the BTAG, we observed or cited in the observations one report of somebody getting some webcams. They set them up in their house, then they sold them or took them back, returned them to the store. Someone else set them up, and they got alerts then that their videos were ready, and they were seeing the new owner's home. So that's, you know, an example. You cited one of, you move out of your house, you have all these devices installed. What happens to some of that historical data? I don't think that's a really well-answered question. And I think often when we think about these devices, we think about them as physical things, not about all of the data. And in large part, the magic of all this stuff is the resulting data and how you can combine that and make recommendations about maybe how to save, you know, energy or make your life easier or what have you. But that also means that that data may be shared with other providers. And how is that shared? And what right do you have over your data as it moves around? Those are, I think, largely unanswered questions. We're just, I think, starting to scratch the surface.
And to your point, Jason, you know, when you have so many different devices in a home or in any setting that are going off to multiple cloud providers, and it's hard to know where all your data is going and who actually owns the data in a real sense. You know, the comments earlier about having some sort of a device to mediate the traffic in your home so you at least know what's going on and have some sense of what traffic there is, where it's going, how secure it is a great notion. It's going to be hard to implement in practice, but I think it's really important. And you hit on a key note. You know, when I leave my house and my Nest thermostat has all this information about me, what happens to that data? Is it something that I can even control? Or am I at the mercy of Google for that?
So the BTAG report does mention one thing about this notion that devices could have a reset button that basically resets their configuration to sort of a factory default, if you will. Now, to give you another sort of wish list item that would be nice to have, hard to implement, I think, you know, we're talking about thermostats, and right now I'm also in the process of moving out of a house with a Nest thermostat and thinking, okay, there's one device. Now when you have, you know, when it's in the walls and when it's every smart switch and outlet and its sensors, et cetera, I don't even think the BTAG recommendations go far enough, because I'm not going to hit reset on 200 devices, many of which I don't even know or remember even are there.
Yeah.
So, in, you know, the wish list would be, what's the reset button for my house?
Let's take another question. There's one up here in the front row.
I come at this from an IT perspective. Now, I write about technology, but I also volunteer with consumer-oriented local and national technology groups, and I think only two of the speakers actually use the word consumer. And so I sit through Q&A sessions at some of these meetings, and people have no clue about what's going on. I will sometimes ask the question, how many people here have updated the firmware in your router? Mm-hmm. And mm-hmm. I get one or two hands raised and a room full of deer in the headlights who have no idea what I'm talking about. And updating the firmware on your router is not an exotic concept. That's been available for 5, 10, however many years. When I bought my iPhone, it came with a tiny little playing card that was not full of writing, and that was the documentation for a very complicated, sophisticated, maybe dangerous device. There's not enough information being given to consumers about what their obligation is in this whole process. This has all been from the industry looking outward, but consumers buy these boxes and they plug them in and they turn them on, and then they don't think about them anymore. There's no documentation, there's no information, there's no encouragement, there's no motivation, there's no incentive for them. They want this to be a toaster. They don't want it to be an internet-attached toaster. They want it to be a toaster that gives them toast, that has a dial for how toasty do you want it to be, and was it frozen when you put it in the toaster, and that's about how far they want to go. And so part of the challenge here is just dealing with the consumer side of the equation and getting them on board as partners rather than obstacles, rather than just non-participants in solving this security of IoT.
I think there's an obligation on both sides. You're right. There is a lack of awareness that partly that's our responsibility to try to increase the level of awareness. But I go back to the car analogy. When you buy a new car or any car, you know that industry has built a lot of safety features into that car. They don't expect you to put your own airbag in or design your own seatbelt. On the other hand, you are expected to drive that vehicle safely. Maybe we teach our kids how to drive in a driver's ed class. Maybe, you know, you're expected not to drink and drive and just to, you know, follow the rules of the road. So there are responsibilities on both sides. That's why industry and consumers, they play, each play a different and important role. But you're right. I believe the awareness is not where it needs to be.
Yeah, I would say, you know, expecting end users to be IT land administrators in the house is just unrealistic. It's not going to happen. From a design standpoint, the designers of the services and the devices have to approach this in a different way, which means, you know, the user is not going to take action. So if there's a software update, to your point, don't expect them to go to a website, figure out how to download it, then how do I FTP it to my device? You know, no one's going to do that. You know, it just has to automatically update itself and not expect the user to have any intervention or involvement at all. And that's sort of the elegance that you'll get to when it just works. It's just there. Because people are just too busy. They've got other stuff going on. They don't want to have to pay attention to these kind of devices.
But it needs to be trustworthy. That whole process you described.
No doubt.
If that's not trustworthy, having it done automatically doesn't make any difference. Because you're downloading malicious code very efficiently. You know, that's a good thing or a bad thing?
Exactly.
I think it's a bad thing.
Your comments resonate a lot, by the way. I think we had a meeting at Princeton last week on IoT security and privacy, and one of the representatives from industry said, these technical solutions are great, but you need to start first with what do consumers actually care about, right? So I think, and we'll do. Well, we know they're not going to do anything as far as software updates, so I think Jason's point on auto updates is a really important one. But even what is awareness and attitudes about your data? Privacy. What do people care enough about that they're going to pay the extra $3 to have protected?
Out of curiosity, how many people in this room know that they have an IoT device in their home? That's a lot. That's a pretty good number. All right, next question over here.
It's Chris Lewis from Public Knowledge. I would argue this is a self-selecting group, though. but glad so many hands went up. We work on consumer advocacy at Public Knowledge. I was a little concerned with the discussion moving towards the responsibility of the company when a lot of the early discussions, whether it's FIP standards or other discussions around data, really emphasize the ownership is a good word of an individual's data. And I certainly agree that I think, you know, if a consumer is not able to do the technical updates, and many of them have no interest in doing the technical updates, I wonder how you guys think companies can move more towards a paradigm of helping consumers understand that they do own their data, putting more of the responsibility and ownership on consumers, but making it simpler from, I don't know if it's providing a service or some other sort of tool that makes it simpler for consumers to understand and actually take greater ownership over their data.
Well, I'll take that at least to start. I mean, it's a great point. I think with privacy and data, there's a couple of things. I mean, companies need to think of it contextually. They need to, you know, the uses of data need to be transparent, and, you know, we can all be better at sort of explaining how data is being used. And also, I mean, I think companies need to be accountable. And so those are high-level principles, but I mean, I think, you know, in with all of this data that's flowing around, those are things that are hallmarks. I mean, for companies to really, and somebody said it, but to differentiate on privacy. But I think part of what we're dealing with here is the cybersecurity, the security concerns are so significant. I mean, we used to say you can't have privacy without security. Or privacy and security are two sides of the same coin. I really do think that you can't have privacy without security. So without and all the good work that, you know, Jason and BTAG and Ron, I mean, are doing, if we can't secure this, then we don't have privacy.
Okay, we have time for one more question.
And the winner is?
It's Garland McCoy with Technology Education Institute, and first I was wondering if anybody here had read the recently released DOE Quadrennial Energy Review. Does anybody know? It's not okay. If you're into this, you really ought to read that, because it does center on the edge of the grid, the fact that we now have billions of devices both connected to the grid and connected to the internet, and what that foretells. So that's one aspect of this. It goes into some other security areas, as well as, for the first time, naming the core internet infrastructure as national security assets, a big deal, which again goes to none of your stuff works, because it's all backhauled in these big data centers that require 50, 100 megawatts of power, 24/7, 365. Anyway. Back, BTAG was set up in 2005, as history dictates. I was with Joe Waz, and I was Tom Talkie and Lee Coing, and I set the thing up as an answer to the Digital Age Communications Act that we were working on at the time at the Progress of Freedom Foundation. That was the origin of BTAG, was to insulate, sort of like the MPAA does, their rating folks. The same model, I would submit to you, can be used to, people aren't going to get invested in this, get up to enough technology that they're going to be, but at the same time, that isn't to say we should walk away and not have some mechanism that is, that again, can be protected the same, and the way BTAG was set up, the same way with MPAA has with their rating system where the studios can't impinge or affect the rating of their products, that will in effect do the patches that will store the information, that will have sort of in effect control or somewhat ownership over this. Otherwise, the government steps. You know, that's, and again, I would treat all of you guys, because it is a little scary, the recently released DOE Quadrennial, because it does really hit on this. Secondly, it's basically nationalization light. So, I mean, the recommendations. Thanks.
All right. We are running up against lunch, which is always a tough spot. But if one or two people want to give a quick answer, and then, you know, we should thank our fantastic panel.
Well said.
It's
well said.
Well, and just to chime in on BTAG, I mean, you're absolutely right, Garland. you know, the work that BTAG is doing and the engineering and sort of the Jason that you guys are working on, it's so critical to policymakers because, you know, for policymakers to be able to understand, I mean, policymakers are not engineers. Engineers are not policymakers. But the work that you're doing is so critical because, I mean, we've seen it in net neutrality. We saw it in BitTorrent. We've seen it in lots of different things. But, I mean, you know, the work is progressing and maturing, and you know, we need more efforts like BTAG.
And it's not owned by anybody. The nice thing, again, it's like Equinix Global Peering Center out there. Equinix was set up as a neutral, so that it wouldn't be owned by AT&T or Verizon or whatever at the time. It would be a neutral global peering center.
I like your comments, and it's definitely food for thought thinking about BTAG as a rating mechanism. I wanted to just come back one quick comment to Chris's comments on data ownership. Mm-hmm. One of the recommendations that the report makes is that devices should have minimal function even when they're not connected to the back end, to the back end cloud server without internet connectivity, et cetera. This is something that basically ties security and privacy together. On the one hand, it's sort of the device should function even if these back end, et cetera, the critical infrastructure is under attack. On the other hand, there's a privacy related and data ownership twist to that as well, which is that I, as a consumer, when I buy the thermostat or the toaster or whatever, I should be able to choose what data is leaving my home.
Thank you all so much for a great conversation.
One thing I would add, for folks that are interested, the Internet Society released a report on IoT that you may find illuminating. You can get to it at internetsociety.org/IoT. I urge you to check it out. Thank you.